Nathan Lydgate is a personal development organization committed to equipping people across 6 domains: personal development, entrepreneurship, administration, workplace relationships, leadership, and organizational success. We do seminars such as this one. We post articles just to ensure that we are equipping the man that will develop the world that we live in today. The focus of today's seminar is on leadership. And I've tried to title it, The Focus of Leaders. The Focus of Leaders. The Focus of Leaders. What exactly should leaders focus on? What exactly should leaders pay attention to? You know, the issue of leadership is so commonplace that we have oftentimes ignored the value it possesses. It's so commonplace now that you find everybody talking about leadership. Those who have even never experienced anything leadership talk about leadership. I'll be showing to you in this seminar what you need to know to lead excellently well and what things you need to pay attention to. We have leadership at different levels, and I'll be showing you the levels of leadership from 2 dimensions. But the ultimate thing you need to know here is we all have been created. We all here have been created for a measure of significant influence. All of us came to this world with a mandate to influence certain things. What then should our attention be on? What should we devote our skills to? What should we devote all of our energies to? And that's the central theme of this presentation this evening. So what is leadership? What is leadership? I'll give you just 2 definitions in a simple paraphrase. Leadership is showing the way, number 1. Leadership is showing the way. Leadership is showing the way. Please come, sir. Let's applaud your Made. Now, this is your Made, and this is Muyiwa. If I have to lead your Made outside this hall, what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to show him how to get out of the place by guiding him or possibly even holding his hands. Leadership is about showing the way. Thank you, sir. Leadership is about showing the way. It refers to giving directions. It refers to giving what? Directions. Leadership is about showing the way. To lead is to show the way. To lead is to do what? Show the way. Number 2, point of reference for leadership. Leadership is achieving results. Leadership is achieving results. Leadership is achieving results. So to lead is to achieve results. These are the 2 perspectives upon which what I'm going to be sharing tonight is based upon. To lead is to show the way, and to lead is to achieve results. Are we together? Are we together? So let's get back to it. I said to lead is to do what? To lead is to do what? To lead is to show the way. And when you are leading, when you are showing the way, you are doing three things. Number one is to what? Cast the vision. Number two. Create a process. And number three. Now listen, friends. John Maxwell said in one of his laws of leadership, it's called the law of navigation. Anyone can steer the ship, but it takes the leader. Anyone can steer the ship, but it takes a leader to chart the course. When we say leadership is about showing the way, we mean the course to follow is determined by the leader. The course to follow is determined by the leader. It's the leader that says, this is where we are going. And then every other person follows. All right? We say the leader creates the process. He's the one that draws what we call the master plan. He's the one that draws the strategy. These are the ways we're going to engage our resources. These are the way we're going to engage the environment. These are the way we're going to engage 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 things to achieve this goal. And then we say that showing the way connotes also suggests that you must be able to identify potential. You must know who has what energies. You must know who has what resources that must be deployed within the process to achieve the goal. So leadership is not about taking a position or wearing a title. CEO does not mean that you are truly a leader. Many people have taken titles and mistaken titles for leadership. Leadership is not about wearing titles. It's about ensuring that you move from one point to the point of realizing the vision. Number two definition we gave, we said that to lead is to achieve results. And also you find that on 3 points. Number one, the leader achieves results by one, setting up teams. Because one is too small a number to achieve greatness. One is too small a number to achieve greatness. So in achieving results, the leader must set up teams. Complementary teams. Who has what energies? Who has what resources? Who has the strengths? Who has his weaknesses? And then you bring them together. Number two thing he does as he achieves results is to empower people. To empower people is not to give them money. To empower people suggests that you equip them by giving them responsibilities that stretches their potential for manifestation. You empower people by giving them opportunities to stretch their potentials for manifestation. So I'm empowering you when I give you an assignment that I know you have a little strength to accomplish, but in delivering that assignment, I stretch you. That's what empowerment means. I may give you money. And if I'm not equipping you by giving you information and relevant things, you may not be empowered. Have you not seen many empowerment programs that have failed in this part of the world? They call people who are doing entrepreneurship empowerment program. And they give all the budding entrepreneurs, the startups, give them $1,000 or you have a foundation, a Chidin Banisi Foundation. And then Chidin Banisi Foundation says, hey, we're going to be giving out 20,000 naira to all secondary school students who want to start a business. 20K is not even enough in the first place. The person you have even given the 20K to, it's not even able to continue. Have you seen programs like Dragon's Den die? How many of you know Dragon's Den, that series? They just started and it's not sustainable. You come to pitch your idea, somebody gives you money, and then you go. Before you know it, we're not even finding them on TV anymore. There's another show called The Entrepreneur. It's not sustainable in this part of the world. Why? Because empowerment is not about giving money. It's not about giving resources as much as it's about giving opportunities. Number three thing you do when you are achieving results as a leader is that you complete a task. The leader that achieves results achieves it by completing a task. I've always said effort is meaningless when goals are not achieved. Effort is meaningless when goals are not achieved. You are not a leader if after committing your energies to a particular effort, you are not achieving the results. If you are not achieving the result, you are not getting the bottom line, then you are not a leader. Leaders are marked by results, not by intentions. Hello? Hello? Leaders are marked by results and not by intentions. Your reputation is formed based on results and not on plans. Leaders are marked by results and not by intentions. So you don't become a leader by thinking about greatness, by thinking about a new product, by thinking about a great sales strategy, by thinking about a plan to capture the market. You are a leader when you have captured the market. You are a leader when you have engaged that plan and you have achieved results. So let's go back and do a quick review. Our first definition of leadership suggests that what? To lead is to show the way. And when you show the way, what are you doing? Number one, you're casting the vision. You're creating a process. You're identifying potentials. Number two dimension of our leadership definition is what? To lead is to?
Achieve results.
To lead is to achieve results. How do we achieve results? By doing what? Number one, setting up teams. Number two,
empowering
people. Number three, completing the task. I think you need to clap for yourself. You guys are good. Now, let me run quickly and show you the levels of leadership. The levels of leadership. And you will need to be particularly attentive in this way. If you Google levels of leadership, there are two that will come out for you. One is the pyramid style of leadership, which we look at as levels of management. And the other that will come out for you, even if you Google up to the 20th page, is John Maxwell's five levels of leadership. As I teach you levels of leadership here tonight, I will also bring up a case in point, if possible two, and if possible three. Cases, faith-based, biblical cases, to show you what levels of leadership abound, particularly in scriptures. The first explanation of levels of leadership classifies leadership into three levels. One, the bottom level of leadership. The bottom level. Two, the middle level. And three, the top level. Remember, this seminar is about the focus of leaders. What exactly should the leaders focus on? So if we agree that there are leaders who show the way at the bottom, if we agree that there are leaders who achieve results at the bottom, what exactly should they be focusing on? The leader at the bottom should not be focused on the same thing as the leader in the middle. The leader at the middle should not be focused on the same thing as the leader at the top. Okay, but John Maxwell shows us five levels of leadership. Number one, he calls it the position level. Level one, he calls it the position level. On this level, what matters to you is your role. You have a role. You've taken a job. But you see, friends, we should know something as we all find ourselves in leadership opportunities that the goal of the institution, the goal of the organization is more important than the role that you have in that organization. Achieving the goal is more important than having a role. Your role notwithstanding, what is germane to the organization is the goal they want to achieve. So I can be taking a rather insignificant role, but once the goal of the organization is achieved, we all go out with results. If leadership is about achieving results, the role is not important. What is most important is the goal. But John Maxwell says that your first entry into leadership is by position. You are made the class rep. But he says as you go on in these five levels, you don't leave the other level. It's not like the first three leadership that you must have moved from bottom to middle, and then from middle you have moved to the top. But he says you don't leave the levels. So you take first position, the first level, at the position level where your role is about people follow you at this point because they have no choice. They've got no choice. You are the governor of your state. Everybody has got to call you Your Excellency. Otherwise, they are insubordinate. You're moving, they must salute. You are the commander-in-chief of the Federal Republic of your nation. Everybody must call you Your Excellency. Before elections, you were not Your Excellency. If they call you that means they were just prophesying, as it were. Oh, very soon we'll be calling you Your Excellency. But once you become president, once you become governor, they begin to assert a title to you, Your Excellency. But when you cease to be president, what happens? Do you cease to be a leader? Number two level, according to John Maxwell, is what we call the permission level. The permission level. At this level of leadership, what's most important is your relationship, the influence you've gained around people by relationship, by relating with them. People now follow you, not because of your roles, not because of your title, not because of the position you have in an organization, but because they have a relationship with you. They can tell that you are about taking them somewhere. And friends, listen, all of us will find ourselves in one position of leadership or the other. You must learn to know how to transit from having a title to having no title. The man called Robin Sharma. Robin Sharma wrote a book called A Leader Without Title. A Leader Without Title. There are people with titles. The moment they leave office and they don't have any title, their influence dips. They are not able to accomplish anything. Remember, leadership is about showing the way. And leadership is about what? Number two, achieving results. But we do it across these levels. But if you have a position, it's easy. You are the class rep. Everybody must submit assignment to you. If you are collecting ID cards, they must submit their ID cards to you. You are the CEO. Everybody must listen to you. You are the HR. If the HR asks you to submit your documents, won't you submit it? Submit your career development plan. You must submit it to HR. But there are some other people that we submit our career development plans to that don't have any titles over us. We must get to the position where our leadership influence is based on the relationship we have with people. That's what John Maxwell calls the second level. Number three level, according to John Maxwell, is what he calls the production level. Production level. The production level. At the production level, your influence is enhanced by your results. Your influence is enhanced by your results. At the position level, your influence is enhanced by your role. At the permission level, your influence is enhanced by your relationships. At the production level, your influence is enhanced by your result. Excuse me, sirs and ma'ams. If you see someone who is achieving a result and you have an opportunity to be under his leadership, you will follow because it's got proofs to show. The moment you have someone that has proofs to show, he will naturally command followership. People who have no proofs have no followers. Otherwise, they may be coercing people by titles. True leaders have genuine followers because they command results. So if you want to command if you want to have your influence increase in life, generate results. Do you know how many students that have great grades have so many followings? Followings in the terms of when they speak about a particular matter where they are generating great results, people listen to them. In the first edition of the law, 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership by John Maxwell, he talked about one law called the law of E.F. Hutton. that says, when the leader speaks, the people listen. When the leader speaks, the people listen. They will only listen when you've got proofs. Nothing silences opposition like proofs. Nothing commands respect like results. Nothing silences opposition like proofs. And nothing commands respect like results. The third level of leadership, according to John Maxwell, is the production level. Your influence is enhanced by your results. Number four level. People development level. People development level. People development level. At this level, your influence is enhanced by your ability to reproduce other people. Your ability to raise other leaders. Remember, you have gone beyond your title. You've gone beyond just mere relationships. In fact, your results are great. But now, you are getting people up. You are coaching people. You are influencing people across the spectrum of five levels of influencers. In some of our past previous seminars, we've talked about the five classes of influencers. One, your parents. Number two, your mentors. Three, your role models, your coaches, and then your sponsors. All of them are leaders. But you see, at that level, you are reproducing after a particular kind. That's another level of leadership. And you may ask yourself, even as you look at all these levels of leadership, am I really, what level am I? Remember, John Maxwell said that the entry level is position. Maybe you don't even have a position yet. But you may be generating results. Okay? You may be generating results. Let's look at number five. Level number five is the pinnacle level. Pinnacle level. It calls it pinnacle. And here, you have become a person of respect by the values you add. You have become a person of respect by the values you add. People just follow you because they respect you. You have so much developed your reputation. You are a people developer. You are result-oriented. You've got so much proofs. You are very relational. You've enhanced yourself by using your position rightly. Now you're just respected. You've become an institution all to yourself. Friends, do you know that some people today in this world, all you need to put on the package of an envelope sent to them is their name? No address to get to them. Bishop David Oyedepo. Put it in the mailbox. They'll bring it to Canaan land. Pastor Enoch Adejari Adeboye. No address. They get it to him. That's the pinnacle level. Where your name is an institution. Where your name becomes a force to be reckoned with. You know, we get to such a level that anybody bearing our names after us is not the real person. At that level, when you bear that name, you are the real person. Any other person is not the real person. When you say you are looking for Pastor Adeboye, do you know how many Pastor Adeboyes are in this world? So many, but we all know one. They say, no, this is not the real. They call all the others fake. Immediately, they call them fake. But they are not fake. But they've not got to the pinnacle level where their name silences other names. When you get to the peak of your leadership, at your name, things answer. Your name becomes the main reference point. You see, friends, that's what we should chase on in leadership. So I want to stand someday and they say, Olumuyiwa Oludayo, second to none, first among equals. Not that I'm chasing a title or I'm chasing a ranking, but by virtue of my results, by virtue of the proofs I've gained, and by the virtue of the people I've raised, I cannot but be put at that level. Bill Gates is Bill Gates. If I say, how many of you know William Gates? There's the tendency that for me to say William Gates. What does he do? Well, if I say, how many of you know Bill Gates? Say, oh, I know him. That's it. But let me show you what these levels of leadership are determined by. What are the determinants for these levels of leadership? What are the determinants for these levels of leadership? Whether they be the three level or the five levels, as John Maxwell may have espoused it. What things determine the levels of leadership? What things determine the levels of leadership? Number one, span of control. Span of control. You will not be given influence over so many at the beginning. You'll be given influence over a few. As you grow in leadership, your span of control, the people under your sphere of influence, begins to widen. And so what determines your level of leadership is how many people are you able to influence. Your span of control is one of the determinants. So you can ask yourself and test yourself, evaluate yourself. Really, how many persons am I able to influence? Whether by virtue of my titles or without my titles. Number two determinant is value expectation. Value expectation. What am I expecting as a contribution, or what is expected as a contribution from me? Do you know, friends, the man who leads a department has certain value expectations. But the man who leads the college has greater demands on him. Why? One, the span of control is wider. But the expectation of the populace, even the expectation of the stakeholders, is also more. And so as you have more expected from you, you should know your level of leadership has changed. Number three, determinant of your levels of leadership. I'm going to five. Number three is the impact of your performance on the whole organization. The impact of your performance on the whole organization. What is the impact of your actions, reactions, or inactions? You know, some people have had their counsels become laws. And some have had their suggestions become what? Instructions. When some people make some suggestions, it sounds like an instruction. What is the impact of your actions, reactions, or inactions on the organization? There are certain people who will not do anything, and their inaction will mean nothing, have no effect. But there are some, their silence is a danger. It's a danger zone, it's a danger point. We'll shut down now. Now let's go into part two. A case in point in the levels of leadership. We're going to be using a Bible-based case. Moses was called to lead the children of Israel, the nation of Israel. He was the top leader, or what we can call the pinnacle leader. Remember, we're talking about what the focus of leaders should be. In scriptures, Exodus chapter 18, Moses had the responsibility of dispute resolution, had the responsibility of advocacy, had responsibility for culture, cultural integration, had responsibility for teaching and equipping the people, had responsibility for an exemplary lifestyle. All of those things were his burdens. until his father-in-law, named Jethro, came around to see him at work. Jethro came to the workplace and saw Moses at work. He arrived the night before. Moses came home in the morning at 2 a.m. Jethro was sleeping, so upon arrival, he did not meet him. So later in the morning, when he woke up, Moses was gone. And the man woke up at 5:30 a.m. Moses was gone. So he went out and left the tent where he stayed and saw Moses in the office and saw his secretary. He said, I would like to see Moses. He said, okay, sir, are you on an appointment? I said, but I'm his father-in-law. He said, actually, all those people lined up, we have about 1,000 people who are scheduled for today. They're supposed to be meeting with him. I said, no. Can I see him before he meets 1,000 people? He said, So Moses heard the voice and came out. Oh, good to see you, sir. I'm sorry. I came in quite late, early hours of this morning. And then this leadership responsibility. I'm supposed to be at work again. This morning, 1,000 people to meet today. Last night, I met 1,500. Tomorrow, I'm going to be meeting about 3,000. And the man said, hey, what's happening to you? Why are you doing all this work? He said, wow, that's my responsibility. At this level, you should not be doing this. There should be other people doing this. It is a leadership responsibility, but not for you at this level. Please listen to this case in point and my explanations. There are leadership responsibilities meant for each level. There are certain things that a CEO must not do. It is a leadership responsibility, but at a different level. Imagine that it's time for a university to have a public lecture. Should it be the responsibility of the chancellor of that university or the vice chancellor of that university to ensure that the tables have been laid very well? There's someone else who possibly is the head of protocol or head of events. A leader at that level, responsible for discharging that assignment. Jethro said, oh my God, you're going to kill yourself. Okay, what's this person's problem? He said, his son was rude to him in the morning. So he brought the case. Okay, so you are attending to a case of a father and son because the son was rude to him. He said, sir, I'm the leader. I've got to do it. Okay, what about this woman? He said, our own case is a little milder. She woke up in the morning and left without making food for her husband. So her husband told her not to return home. I've sent for him now, hoping that he will join us very shortly. Okay, what about this other person? See her, it's a business case. He defrauded a partner. And Jethro said, wait a minute. You mean you're going to attend to this big case, small case, medium-sized case, only you? He said, when I was given the terms of reference for my assignment, all of these things were listed. Terms of reference for leadership, dispute resolution, cultural integration, advocacy. He said, but I've got to do it. He said, but come on, Moses, there are other people who have what you have. Remember I said that leaders know how to identify potential. Don't do it alone. And Jethro provided to him 5 levels of leadership. He said, appoint captains over tens. There are certain people who will be able to manage tens of people, meaning they will not reach hundreds. So 60, 70, maximum is 90 that they can manage. Captains over tens, in multiples of tens, all right? So some other people can manage them in multiples of 50s, second level of leadership. Okay, so for this kind of people, give them responsibility in the 50s. Send them, for this first person, give him 10 cases per time. This one can manage 50 cases, level 2. This person, level 3, he can manage 100 cases. Level 4, can manage 1,000 cases. Level 5, that's you. What then should your focus be on? That's what I'm going to show you now. Jethro established 5 levels of leadership. Remember, we said the determinant. Based on the span of control. Based on span of control, you will attend to 10 people. You cannot control more than 10 people. You 50. So if you are not able to attend to 10, he said, whatever matter they have that is bigger than them, let them escalate to you. So you should have a room for escalation. So they are also representatives of the people within their sphere of influence. Remember I said span of control is one determinant of your level of leadership. Let's see how Jethro advised Moses. At this level, five levels I just mentioned, captains over tens, captains over 50s, captains over hundreds, captain over 1,000, and captain over all. That was Moses, captain over all. The determinants at these levels were span of control. You be in charge of this number of people per time. Number two determinant for Moses at that point was the weight of responsibility. You can't put this kind of weight of responsibility on yourself. This guy cannot represent the people before God. Okay? So that should be you. There are responsibilities that we cannot give to the middle level leaders that must be executed and discharged by the top level. Do you know when some people, I once worked in the bank, and if we are going on a call to a customer's place, maybe to show him some of our accounting, our banking products, to win his account, to mobilize his deposits to our bank, depending on the kind of man we're going to meet, depending on the kind of clients we're going to place a call on, that's how we determine our team. If we're going to someone who has maybe little cash, you know, guys from the East, the guy is not doing badly in his spare parts factory and is doing maybe a turnover of 1 million, 2 million, I can go alone. But if I'm going to a company that's the manufacturer of vehicles, I may need my executive director to go with me. Because at that level, that engagement, that weight of responsibility is too much for me to bear. I need someone else to join on me. Now, number three determinant for them there was the effect of their performance on other people. If you give this guy kids of 50 people, if he messes up, it will have a far-reaching effect on more people. But give him 10. With 10 people, whether he does well or not, the effect will not be so significant. But it's okay. Now, what has the focus? What were the roles and responsibilities? Jethro said, see, Moses, you've been doing everything. You've been doing dispute resolution. You've been doing internal representation. Because escalation is internal representation. Something happens in your department. You can't handle it. You escalate to the next level. The next level is not able to handle it. They escalate to the next level until it gets to management. But all of those things are internal representation. They are certain people, as good as they are, they cannot represent you externally. External representation is at a level of leadership. What we call corporate representation. It's at a level of leadership, and you need to know that. Now, Moses was involved in dispute resolution. He was involved in internal representation. He was involved in representation, external representation. At this point, representing the people before God. He was involved in teaching the people God's decrees. Moses told Jethro, he said, hey, I'm supposed to teach them God's decrees. I'm supposed to be showing them the way to live. I'm supposed to be showing them how to behave. So he had six roles to perform. But you see, these roles, as little as they may have been, two of them were weighing him down. Dispute resolution. So he would sit to resolve disputes morning till night. We're told by King Solomon, he said, the labor of the fool, the effort of the fool does not weary himself alone. He wearies every other person. Why? Because this man does not know how to engage. See, ignorance in engagement is what brings about weariness. Ignorance in engagement leads to weariness. You will exhaust yourself. You will exhaust your resources because you are ignorant of the approaches to engage. You know, many people who are leaders of their companies, they say, I'm CEO of my company, it's a startup, I'm doing everything all by myself. At a particular time, yes, it may be necessary to do everything all yourself. But as you grow, as you expand, you've got to shed off some things. And so Jethro said to him, let these guys do it. Now, this is what you should do. Jethro told him, this is what you should do. Number one, this is your focus. Level 5 focus of leadership for you, Moses. Be a representative of the people before God. Be an advocate. Listen, friends, the top leader, the focus of the top leader is advocacy. The focus of the top leader is advocacy. So if you are the topmost person in an organization that you find yourself, for example, you're the chairman of the alumni association, that's the top level of that association. Your role is advocacy. You are not in charge of dispute resolution, except the one escalated to you, because you'll be weary. You know how many members you have, maybe thousands. And so someone is saying, hey, they didn't allow me to pay my dues. They didn't allow me to do that. And they bring it to you all the time. You will be weary. And that's why there's a lot of distraction in institutions who are supposed to be championing discipline and at the same time championing creativity. Because where there's so much indiscipline, the man who's supposed to be championing creativity also is burdened with ensuring discipline. I mean, a typical example is covenants. You have the dean of students responsible for discipline. He's also responsible for student development. Now, there's a lot of discipline responsibility that he wants to ensure that is done. So while he's doing all that, he misses out on student development. Creative programs don't come to place. As a top leader in that department, he shelves it and gives it to maybe a captain over 1,000. Someone who is able to deliver it, that has the capacity to do so. So number one responsibility or number one focus of a top leader, what we can call a level 5 leader, is advocacy. Number two is culture, cultural integration. The top leader is responsible for the culture of the organization. Moses said, hey, I will be teaching the people God's decrees. I'll be teaching them God's decrees. The culture is important. The culture is important. See, as the top leader, and I'm going to be using you, your money a lot. You're the chairman of the Landmark University Alumni Association, right? Now, you are responsible for the culture of that association, not your financial secretary, not your PRO. Your PRO has a responsibility, but you are responsible for the advocacy. You are the one to take their case before the university management. You are the one responsible for ensuring that there are ethical conducts, acceptable patterns, a lifestyle that forms the identity. See, what we do with the culture is what informs the identity of the people. And so, if your organization must have its identity, the responsibility for the identity formation is based on the top leader, not on the middle level leader or on the bottom leader. Number three focus of the top leader is an exemplary lifestyle. Exemplary lifestyle. Exemplary lifestyle. Exemplary lifestyle. Moses said, I'm supposed to be showing them the way to live. Remember I said leadership is about showing the way. I'm supposed to show them the way to live. How are you supposed to live? Look at me. This is the way I'm living. A lifestyle. Because believe me, friends, all of us at one point or the other have taken after the people that we have seen. David wrote to me, this your hairstyle is taken from who? Your dad. Simple. And I saw his picture sometime on Facebook. So some of us do certain things because we saw our role models do it. Some of us even make our hair because we saw some of our mentors do it. Some of us even talk like our mentors talk. But if our mentors do bad things, believe me, unknowingly we may be doing it. Mannerisms. So the responsibility of the top leader, knowing fully well that he's above every other person, and they look to him for direction, is to ensure that his lifestyle is appropriate. So you are the top leader. Don't dress the way you don't want your people to be dressed. Don't use the language you don't want them to use. Because if they say the boss is saying bullshit. So when you come to the office and somebody's not doing something, they say bullshit. And then they see you doing the bullshit. So they'll come and say, hey guy, what's this bullshit? You say, ah. Now it affects the culture. But that's what your lifestyle shows and depicts. That's the focus of the top leader. And finally, the focus of the top leader is that of a reference point. He said, I'm going to show them how to behave. When your influence ceases to become a reference, it does not change the experience of other people. When your influence ceases to become a point of reference, it does not change the experience of other people under your sphere of influence. It doesn't change them. You're a reference point. Now, that's a case in point. What are the qualities that Jethro gave to Moses? He said, hey, look from among this people, men, not boys. Men, not boys. With all due respect to the ladies, men there, let's take it to be generic. It talks about mature. Leadership responsibilities are not given to the immature. Leadership responsibilities, even at the bottom level, is for the mature. Remember, he said, captains over tens. But let them be men. Men are in degrees. The man on captain level number one, having 10 people, is different from the man that is managing 50. They are both men. But you see, life is in faces. Men are in what? Sizes. We may all have the same physical statistics. But believe me, what we are able to bear differs. Some people have a strong threshold for bearing pain. When I was much younger in secondary school, was it secondary school or primary school? Much younger before I came to university. I had a neighbor. Her name is Hawa. Hawa is as fair as, let me see who's here and that is fair. Nobody is as fair as Hawa. Hawa is in between albino and being an Oyibo. In between. Very, very fantastic lady. When we offend our parents then, they used to flog us. And we say, stretch forth your hands. They would not flog us on our palm. Our lesson teachers then, in our small community, our lesson teachers would not flog us on our palm. They would flog us on our wrists. And so when it's time, when you have offended, and they say, everybody line up. First person, come out. They've not beaten you, you are doing like this. It's already wet, your hands are already wet. You're doing like this. And your pain threshold is low. How I will come. Bye. And we're all wondering, oh my God. So you're wondering, okay, yes, when I get there. I will do the same thing. A lady, me a guy, and you go. It's your turn. And you go. And you're wondering, what did you do? You made it look like there was no pain. But you see, listen, the pain threshold is different. The same way, there are men and there are men. There are some boys to men. There are some that remain boys. Some have moved from boys to men. But you see, what's important is about the capacity, the maturity. He said, look for men. Friends, you will never get any responsibility above your level of maturity. You will never get any responsibility above your level of maturity. You will never get any responsibility above your level of maturity. It is maturity that allows people to confer responsibility upon you. Maturity means a lot. You are able to delay gratification. You are able to know when to respond to issues. Number two quality was godly. He said, look for men that fear God. Godly here means you have a consciousness of the supernatural, as it were. Godly in character. People who have a reverence for higher authority. Reverence for higher authority. Listen, friends, if you are a leader and you don't know how to submit yourself to higher leaders, and if you think you are the highest leader, the thing you must submit yourself to are the ways, the customs, the doctrines, the cultures, the principles that govern the people. That you are the CEO does not mean you are not responsible to any other person. You are the chairman of the board. Does not mean you own everything. There are terms of reference of the board, and they are dictated so as to guard and guide your actions. So men who take leadership responsibility must be people who have a reverence for higher authority. Number three quality are people of integrity. People who are whole, home and abroad. Who are the same at home, the same at work, the same on the streets, the same in a restaurant, the same on social media, the same on formal media, the same on news media, the same everywhere. Leaders are whole people. Your lifestyle is not fragmented. You are not a pope at home and a robber at work. You're not a saint in church and a robber on the streets. Integrity suggests being whole, being complete. Number four quality is contentment. Contentment. Fourth quality of leaders. Contentment. Remember, we're still looking at the case in point between Moses and Jethro. Contentment. Men who are not covetous. That's what he asked him. People who are satisfied with what they have. Friends, do you know some people are at the top? They earn about ₦1 million per month. Yeah, they still want to steal more money. They still want to steal more money. I've said this thing before, and this is with due respect to the ladies. It doesn't mean that you guys are not ever satisfied. But how many people here know how much money is enough for a woman? Just a little more. If you give your woman, and I'm sure my wife is not hearing this. Now, if you give a woman 10,000 naira, and you ask her, is that okay? The possible response you get is, you can just add a little more. A little more is just the best addition. If you give your woman, I've not given my wife 1 million naira before. I pray to give her one day. I'm sure she's expecting maybe tomorrow. But if you give her $1 million and say, hey, I mean, would that be okay for this trip? Would that be okay for this? Say, well, I don't mind a little more. But when these women say so, it is not out of greed or covetousness. But you find some people, they own so much. They have so much, yet they want more. And in wanting more, covetousness suggests that you deprive other people. Your focus is on other people's resources that you do not possess. But those who will be leaders will be content with what they have. And that brings me to the third part now. End of the third part of my teaching. Leadership is the product of efficient management of self, task, and resources in a particular field of engagement that produces expected results and guarantees personal satisfaction. Field-centered perspective of leadership. Leadership is the product of efficient management of self, task, and resources in a particular field of engagement that produces expected results and guarantees personal satisfaction. Now, when we talk about field-centered leadership, it suggests, remember, we said leadership is about showing the way. It's about achieving results. Showing the way in a particular field of engagement. Achieving results in a particular field of engagement. Many people are scattered. They have deployed their resources on all kinds of activities. Hence, their results are not tangible. You do a little here. You do a little there. You do a little there. You don't become a leader scattering yourself. You must be focused. We're told that if an eye be single, then your whole body will be illuminated. We are not enlightened enough. If we give our attention to all kinds of things, we spread ourselves so thin that you have multiple potentials. Doesn't mean you'll be doing multiple things. But listen to this, friend. Okay, I'll get there. But many of us have multiple skills. Some of these skills are dominant. Some are dormant. Your dormant skills may not be relevant now in the phase of life that you live. But in the future, in the nearest future, your dormant skills become relevant. And your current dominant skills become dormant. All the skills you possess have relevance in your life and in the pursuit of your agenda. They only take the form of dominance and relevance, or dormant and relevance. At a point, it becomes relevant to the engagement of the hour. And that's when you begin to build upon it. Build upon it. So some people here can't sing professionally. But believe me, if in your vision, if in your pursuit, you have a responsibility for becoming a music producer, you may not know how to sing, but you'll be able to set up the notes. We all know that Don Jazzy cannot sing very well. But he has produced he has produced fantastic talent for Nigeria. I'm sure you know Cobams Asuko. I mean, have you ever heard him singing? He does well, but not as professional as some of the people he has produced. So many people, this guy that does Project Fame, this Uncle Ben. Not all coaches are good players. Some coaches have never played before. Not all great coaches are good players. Not all great coaches are good players. Field-centered leadership. The efficient management of yourself, your task, and your resources in a particular field of engagement. Now we have three dimensions there: yourself, your task, and the resources. But this field is called, I call this field your scope. I call this field your what? Scope. Scope standing for significant circles of personal engagement. Significant circles of personal engagement. Your field, your particular field of leadership is your scope. Your scope is your significant circles of personal engagement. And I'm going to explain with references. Friends, ask yourself this simple question. Where do you see yourself? Or where do I see myself making my utmost contribution to life? This is how to determine the field you belong in. And if you don't know the field you belong in, you cannot lead in it. Remember, to lead means to show the way. Today we see Bishop David Oyedepo as a leader of the Christian faith. He's a leader of the Christian faith. He's not a leader in oil and gas. He's not a leader in the financial industry. He's becoming a leader in education, but not a leader in banking. Are we together? Where do you find yourself making your utmost contribution to life? Your specific field. Today we have what we call leading lawyers. Leading lawyers. They are leading lawyers because in their field, they have shown the way. They have blazed a trail. They have set standards that others are following. They have achieved significant results in their field that others are referencing. And so a field-centered leadership perspective suggests that there is a place that we must be. And there are tasks that we must execute within that domain. And that domain is what I refer to as your significant circles of professional or personal engagement. John Maxwell, my mentor, my role model, one of the greatest influencers of my life in terms of personal development and leadership development, he schooled me and I submitted myself to his tutelage. John Maxwell speaks around topics that are called relationships, equipping, attitude, leadership, mentoring, and success. Six areas. If you check out all of his materials, you can classify them into these six areas. John Maxwell said in one of his teachings that he realized that he is not good at counseling. He also realized that he's not good at administration. And so he delegates that part of his assignment to other people. But he realized that he's good at other things. He's known so much for leadership. But he speaks around those six areas. So he's determined his scope. His significant circles of personal engagement or significant circles of professional engagement. You need to be able to determine your domain. You need to be able to define your scope before you can make a mark. Leaders are those who make a mark. Leaders are those who make a mark in their field. You can't just go on doing everything. Your focus must be on your scope. What exactly am I doing? Now, Nathan Lydgate only speaks and writes around six domains. And we form the word pearls in it. Personal development. So we teach time management, goal setting, vision. We talk about entrepreneurship, how to set up systems for business. We talk about administration. We talk about relationships, workplace relationships. We talk about leadership. We talk about corporate success, pearls. That's our scope. So you will not find me speak outside those six areas. And so it's easy to make a mark. It's easy to show the way. It's easy to achieve results. So you must define it. So the next significant variable in that definition, apart from your field, which we have said is your scope, is yourself. Yourself. You as an individual, because leadership is an efficient management of self. What are you managing? What you have are your multiple competences. What you have are your multiple competences. And they are called, in a word, basket. In the word basket, B standing for your background education. B for your background education. A for your attributes. S for your skills. K for your knowledge. E for experience. T for talent. So when you're managing yourself, you're managing your education. You're managing your personality, your attributes. You're managing your skills, specific things that you are acquiring by training. You're managing your knowledge. What is your perception of the worldview in your field of engagement? How much of your field do you know? Your knowledge. If your field is not determined, your knowledge, how will it be weighed? How will it be measured? And E, your experience. How many things have you gone through? How many situations have you found yourself regarding decisions, regarding activities in your field? Managing yourself. And we talk about your natural talents, your natural endowment. There are things that you need no training for. Some of us do some things naturally. These are the competencies, the multiple competencies of yourself. So when you're managing yourself, you're managing your education. You're managing your attributes. You're managing your skills. You're managing your knowledge. You're managing your experiences. And you're managing your talents. You're planning for it. Number three, key factor in that definition, your task. Your task is indicators within your scope. Performance indicators within your scope. Your task are the performance indicators within your scope. So you find yourself to be a designer. The task within your design could be building designs, could be interior designs as an architect. You define your task within your scope. John Maxwell does seminars. John Maxwell does authorship of books, conferences along these areas. Those are the tasks. So I do trainings, I write books, I conduct seminars, I speak at conferences within my scope. Are we together? So my task, my responsibilities. Dr. Doye Dekwa will tell us, God told him that the hour has come to liberate the world through the preaching of the word of faith. Preaching. So everything he has got to do has to be by the spoken word. And after a while, he said to him, the same word that I've committed into your mouth, same, commit into writing. So the publishing dimension of his task started. The scope, still the same, but the task expanded. Are we together? So in field-centered leadership, if you're going to excel in leadership, yes, your scope is determined. Now you know who you are. You know your basket. The task are the activities that you perform within that scope. So whenever you choose activities, ask yourself, do they fall in line within my scope? Are they within my scope? If they are not, shelf them. And then the final key point there are resources. Resources are provisions that enable you to achieve your goals. Resources are provisions that enable you to achieve your goals. Resources are provisions that enable you achieve your goals. These resources, at this point here, we refer to these resources as external resources. Because your personal resources are the thing that were mentioned as yourself. Okay? Now, other resources here refer to other people. People. Number one resource. People. Other people. One is too small a number to achieve greatness. So you need other people. Two are better than one. Number two, you need finances. You need what? Finances. Money. Two ways to make money. When you work. And two, when your money works for you. When you work. And two, when your money works for you. When you work, the reward for working is money. When you have money, you make it work for you in two ways. There are only two ways to make your money work for you. Believe me, savings and investments. Now, but there are vehicles of savings. There are vehicles of investments. People now invest in the money market. People invest in real estate. People invest in small businesses. People invest in stocks and shares. They invest in all kinds of things. Now, people are talking about Bitcoin, one coin, whatever coin, all those commodities and treasures. You invest in all those areas. You can save. But the money works for you. You need a professional to tell you what investment vehicle will be best for you. People invest in insurance. All kinds of ways of insuring. So number one resource you need, I said, is people. People are the most critical assets. They carry problems. And anywhere you see a problem, there's always a solution. And the reward for solving a problem is money. People are lazy. They can't queue up for food. Somebody sees that an opportunity and calls herself mobile waiter. So you stay in your room, you place an order for food while you are seeing a movie. Somebody's running the errand for you. The person is achieving his own dream. You are achieving your own goal. But for achieving your goal of watching a movie or reading a book and allowing someone else run, the person charges you a premium. The person is happy. He gets the premium. He's able to achieve some other things in his life. You see, entrepreneurial leadership is showing people how to make money by making money. showing people how to make money by making money. Now, making money, open bracket, let's expand that variable. Making money is solving problems, right? So entrepreneurial leadership is showing people how to solve problems or how to get reward for solving problems by identifying the problems. So number one, resource people. Number two, resource finance. Number three, resource are materials. Other materials. Other non-technical, non-tangible material that you require. Number four, money. I talked about money. Number five, a message. How do you represent yourself? Message. What exactly is your value proposition? What do people say about you? What do people say about you? Let me close this segment by talking about the requirements for excelling in your field. The requirements for excelling in your field. Remember, I talked about the fact that leadership is about the efficient management of self, task, and resources. Efficient management of self, task, and resources. And so, what are the things that you need to effectively manage yourself? Number one, vision. You need to give yourself a vision. Where are you going? Where are you going? Of what essence is speed when you are facing the wrong direction? Why would you be engaging all of your resources, your background education, your attributes, your skills, your knowledge, your experience, your talent? Why would you be engaging them outside your scope? Of what essence is that speed when facing the wrong direction? You've got to have a vision. Number two, information. Information. Many of us need to know how to acquire the knowledge, how to acquire the relevant knowledge to excel in our field. Do you know that today many people do business, foreign business, using the parallel market instead of the official market? Foreign international business using parallel market more than the official rate. You need dollars, you get it for 322 naira, right? 322 naira. Official rate is 199. Right? 199. What's the difference? 322 minus 199. 123. Hallelujah. 123. So you are paying 122 naira above per dollar. So if you need $1,000, you pay $123,000 more, 103,000 naira more to get it. You pay 322,000 instead of paying 199,000 to get $1,000, right? But it's how to make, it's how to get the $199, 199 naira to a dollar. You may not know. Others are having it, but you don't know. And not knowing costs you a lot. When you lack information, you waste and squander resources. When you lack relevant information, you waste and squander resources. Number three, I said vision, information. Number three, diligence. Diligence, you must be dutiful. You must be hardworking. These are the requirements to excel at the point of self. At the point of self. Diligence. You must be hardworking. Engage yourself. Commit yourself to tenacious work. Productive work. Creative work. And number four, sacrifice. Go beyond the ordinary. Go beyond the normal point. Go beyond the little way of getting your things done. Go beyond it. Now let's look at task. What do you need to excel at your task? On your task. What do you need to excel at your task? That's one thing. Skill development. Skill development. What do you need to excel at your task? Skill development. Develop your skill. And David led them by the integrity of his heart and the skillfulness of his hands. David fed them by the integrity of his heart and the skillfulness of his hands. Psalms chapter 78 and verse 72 of the Holy Scriptures. David fed them by the integrity of his heart and by the skillfulness of his hands. On the point of task, you need skill development. Acquire skills. And on the point, the third dimension there, resources. Resources, what are the requirements you need to excel at the point of resources? I call them multiple levels of intelligences. Multiple level of intelligence. You need to develop multiple level of intelligences. Multiple level of intelligences. Friends, remember the resources we listed. People, you need emotional intelligence. There are some people that you need to know how to manage. You know, in today's world, one size doesn't fit all. One size, one approach doesn't fit all. The way to attend to a married woman that works with you is not the same way you're going to attend to a widower. It's not the same way you're going to attend to a single parent. Now, you may say, okay, how many people are married here? They are not married. Okay, those who are not married, above 40, are different. I mean, the way you marry them is different way you marry someone who's not married at 24. Because for him, he's still enjoying his life. The other person is reaching extra time. It's injury time. His life is on a pause before menopause. Men don't come, he's on a pause. Menopause. Yes, because, I mean, the men have not come, so the life is on a pause before they reach full stop. You need financial intelligence. How do you manage money? You need contextual intelligence. How do you manage the environment you find yourself? You need historical intelligence. How much of yesterday's issues do I know? Multiple level of intelligences. So this brings me to the end of part four. In conclusion, friends, when you are leading, lay the tracks. Lay the tracks. Determine the field. Lay the tracks. This is the track that we are going to follow to achieve our goal. Because you're showing the way, because you're achieving the results, lay the track. Number two, conclusion. Empower teams. Give assignments to people. Let them fail. Correct them. They will improve. Guide them very well when you're empowering them. Give them all the necessary responsibilities. Give them all the required information. They will perform better under guidance. Do you know, friends, you guys are not in the world of work, but for those of us that work, you know, at times our superiors demand from us what they have not trained us to do. You've not guided me as to do this thing. You've not equipped me with how to do it. All of a sudden, I'm not performing well. Say, why are you behaving like this? Say, but I didn't know. Say, you should know. Should I tell you everything? I say, but... Listen to me, that may be good in some parlance, but an effective leader shows the way. Empower people by guiding them with relevant information. Empower them also by giving them opportunities to express their potential. Do so. Number three, in conclusion, articulate the vision. Never be ambiguous. Never be ambiguous. Be clear. Be clear. Be clear. Be clear. And finally, deliver results. It's not enough to have strategies. You must have results. It's not enough to have solutions. Your solutions must be producing results. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of the third in our series of personal transformation seminars. Having taught us today on the focus of leaders. In part one, we try to define what leadership is. Part two, what do we try to do?
We looked at, what did we look at in part two? What did we look at in part two, everybody? The levels of leadership. In part three, we looked at a case in point. In part four, we looked at the field-centered perspective of leadership. And this is part five. We've concluded by saying, lay the tracks, empower teams, articulate vision, deliver results. To lead is to show the way. To lead is to achieve results. My expectation for every participant here is that the errors you will make in leadership, the mistakes you will make in leadership, will not be on the basis of ignorance. You are not permitted to be ignorant. You're not permitted to be ignorant. Your errors should not be based on ignorance. It should not be. It's not an excuse. Work hard to ensure that you get all that you require to excel.